darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't to me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it. I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Beside you. Good morning and welcome to St Thomas's Church Online. My name is John Scammon. I'm the vicar at St Thomas's Church, but today I'm coming to you from this glorious sunshine of the garden. Thank you so much for joining us week by week. It's great to be with you today. It's funny doing church in your pajamas, which some of you are probably doing this morning, aren't you? And in lots of ways, that is great, isn't it? You get to have a relaxed breakfast. You don't have to do battle with the car park. There's no rotas to fill. There's lots of things that are great about this way of being church. But of course, we miss each other too, don't we? We miss those opportunities to meet each other, to give each other a hug or a handshake, to have a coffee together, to talk with real people. And we miss the chance to pray together as well. And so we face the challenge of that. And of course, there's sung worship. And our sung worship team has done an incredible job of leading us through worship over these last few Sundays. We're really grateful to them for that. But sung worship at home, maybe in our front room, on the sofa, maybe with others, maybe on our own, just isn't quite the same, is it? And of course, the question dividing the nation at the moment is, do you sing along or do you not? In our family, we do. Other people will join in quietly and just listen. That's fine. We're all in different situations. Not all of us are happy to hear our own voices on our own singing along. But once church goes on TV, it's easy for us to slip into a kind of consumer mindset. So you've got Andrew Marr on BBC One. Flick across to Channel 4, you've got Sunday Brunch. Could even try Dress to Impress on ITV2. Oh, and then there's St Thomas's Church on YouTube. Now, unless you're doing Joe Wicks in the morning, actually most of us don't participate in what we're watching on screen. But this isn't a TV program. This is church that just happens to be on telly. Church is the people of God, connecting with God and with each other and sharing the good news of Jesus with the world around us. And that is why we're here today. So let me encourage you this morning as we go through our service together to get stuck in. Worship with us, whether you do that aloud or quietly. Maybe if you have children in your home, you might like to get them some scarves, something to dance and wave during the music, some shakers to play along so that they can participate in the sung worship with us. Let's invite God to speak to us through our Bible reading, through Claire's talk this morning, which is going to be kicking off a new series on prayer. Jeanette's going to be leading us in prayer. Let's take time to listen to God, to quieten ourselves. God is with you on your sofa just as much as he is when we all gather together in the church building. So as we begin our service together this morning, let's quieten our hearts by saying together the prayer of preparation. Let's pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. So let's worship God together now as Phil Sayer leads us in our sung worship.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. All you've done for me.
Promise you'll carry me safe to shore.
us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storm. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storm. Fire before us, you're the brightest, you will lead us through the storm.
Thank you, Emma, Chris, James, and Matthew, for that great illustration that prayer works so much better if we stop to listen to God. I was on a Zoom meeting this week with a bunch of church leaders from around the country, and one of them, Paul Harcourt, who heads up the New Wine Network, said something that I found really arresting. He said, "What can God do when all we can do is pray?" That was a really interesting question. We at St. T's are often pretty activist, aren't we? Many of us live very busy personal lives. We certainly have often quite a busy church life together. But as we go through this extended period when restrictions look set to carry on in some way for quite a while, we're having to confront the reality, actually, that busyness is no longer the answer, if it ever was. The great preacher Charles Spurgeon once said, "Prayer is the slender nerve that moves the muscle of omnipotence." Prayer is the slender nerve that moves the muscle of omnipotence. What can God do when all we can do is pray? Well, we're going to be spending the next 6 weeks getting to find out because we're going to be starting a new series on prayer, and Claire is going to take some of the students who are part of St. Thomas's Church.
For this then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one.
Good morning. We're thinking about prayer today, and prayer is really important, but it is simply spending time with God and talking with him. We can pray any time and any place, but we probably all have different ways in which we prefer to spend time with God. So some of us might like to pray in the morning and others at night. And some of us might have a favourite place where we like to go to spend time with him. And there is no one correct way to pray. But I just want to give us a few thoughts this morning about how we pray and how that conversation might go. So firstly, I want us to think about whether we sometimes forget to pray and have a think about how God is always there, ready to talk to us, even if we're not there, ready to listen.
How are you doing with your schoolwork, your maths and English and things? Are you alright in this lockdown time? Finding things to do? Getting on at church? Your Zoom calls and things? Everything okay? Do you need some help? Can I do anything for you? Hello?
Even when we ignore God, he is there and he's ready to talk to us. So when we pray, God loves it. And we think about prayer as talking to God. But I wonder, what does it look like if we are only talking to God?
Hi, I've been really busy lately, but I've wrote down the list of the things I want to talk to you about. Okay. So I need help with all my homework, obviously, you know, my maths, my English, my chemistry, my biology, yeah, my RE, all of that. Also, I have some other requests. My friends and me are falling out, could do with some help with that.
Yeah.
Also, you know, them wars, they're kind of pretty sad, you know? And also global warming, it's not such a good situation, is it? And also, my grandma's not very well, to be honest with you. I just wish she was getting better. And also, homelessness, like, that's not very good, is it? And also, this blooming pandemic, it's really annoying. And whilst we're on the topic of pandemics, all the other illnesses that, you know, they could be done with. Also, I could do with a new bike, that'd be pretty good. Alright, see you later.
Well, I kind of wish he'd stayed around because we could have worked on some of that stuff together.
I know I've been guilty of this, of listing all my problems and all my worries and not really giving any time to God to give me any answers or talk to me or reassure me. Well, God still loves it if we do just do a long list to him, because he loves to hear from us and he still answers our prayers. But how much better would it be if we have a conversation with God and not only talk to him, but listen to?
I felt that with George when we laughed at me.
Well, I'm not surprised to hear that. Perhaps I need to be teaching you two a little bit of patience, don't you think?
Mm.
Now, I have been thinking about your grandma in this time of lockdown and that she might be a little bit, maybe, sad. Do you think there might be something you can do about that? Give her a call?
Yeah,
something like that?
I think I could give her a call.
Okay, that'd be great.
I've been thinking a lot about global warming.
Well, that's very good. I'm pleased to hear that you have. Maybe that's something that we can think about and do together. All right?
Yeah, sounds good.
Give us a hug.
So this week, let me encourage you to remember to pray and to just have a go if you haven't prayed before. And when you are praying, remember to not only talk to God, but listen as well and just see what he has to say to you.
I don't know about you, but my head has just been mush over the last few weeks. I feel like there's been so much to learn and adapt to. There's a whole online world of socialising and connecting that I didn't even really know existed before this that I've had to learn. So my IT skills have really developed in this time. We as a family, like many families, have had to learn how to do homeschooling and what that looks like for us, as well as trying to learn how to work from home as well, with the house being so full. Some of us, I guess, have had to learn how to be alone for long periods of time, and you know, I think there's a real learning curve in learning how to do that and do it well, while others of us in the same way have had to learn how to be with people for really, really long stretches. And I think there's a challenge in both of those. We've been watching the government each day doing their daily updates while we as a nation try to work out how do we do this, how do we move together and get through a global pandemic. How do we do that well? What do we need to do? How do we need to work together to do that? So much to learn, and our homes have changed too, haven't they? Our homes have become medical isolation units and offices, schools. They've maybe become gyms if we're trying to stay fit at home and doing different kind of exercising in our homes, as well as trying to be places where we rest and have fun together. If you follow our Connect emails, then on Tuesday you'll know that we were reminded that our homes are also now churches. And so here we are on Sunday, or whenever we're watching and catching up, here we are doing church in our living rooms or kitchens or wherever it is that you're watching. And today we are beginning a new sermon series titled How to Pray,
as we are going to go on a journey together over the next few weeks, exploring how can we pray well in this time. And it might be that you're listening to me say this and just at your wit's end and just like, Claire, please don't give me anything else to do. Like, we have got enough balls in the air here. We are struggling through this time. Please don't overwhelm me with any more to do. And can I hope to bring you some comfort that being the church at home isn't something that we must do in addition to the other things, but it actually is something, is who we are. We are the church and we are at home. And we've talked so many times, haven't we, about how the church is not the building, it's the people. And so we the people are at home at the moment, and so therefore the church is at home. That's where we are. And praying isn't something that we want to add to a long list of things that we need to do. You know, as if like that's what the good Christians do, and we kind of feel guilty when we don't pray because it's something we ought to do. But rather, I want to remind us that prayer is speaking with someone. And that someone is God. It's not just something we do, but it is a being, it's a person that we come to in prayer. And so if we feel that prayer is primarily something that we must do when we feel bad when we don't do it, or if maybe we feel that prayer for us is almost like shooting out our requests or our wish list out into the dark abyss and hoping that maybe someone is there, and if we've perhaps done it right, then the message will get through and they may or may not respond to our prayers, then I want to really encourage you that there are so many wonderful things about prayer, that if we learn to pray well, then our lives are actually enriched in so many different ways. In Luke's account of the gospel reading that we had before, just a moment ago, it begins describing the scene that Jesus was praying in a certain place. And when he returned, his disciples asked him to teach them how to pray. The disciples saw Jesus praying regularly, and then when he returned with life-giving words and wisdom and healing and purpose. And the disciples were fed by Jesus in his own kind of life of prayer, but I think that the disciples realised that this wasn't enough, it wasn't satisfying them, and quite rightly, they too wanted to live as Jesus did, so that they could have words of life and wisdom and healing and purpose too. There's an old proverb that says, give a man a fish and you feed him for a day. Teach a man to fish and you feed him for a lifetime. Jesus wanted his disciples to have spiritual food from heaven for their whole lifetime. And so he taught them how to pray. And we're in a new time now, aren't we? Perhaps before COVID-19, if we're hand on heart honest, maybe some of us were content to just go to church each week to get our weekly portion of fish, our spiritual feast that saw us through the week, and perhaps we didn't give God a second thought from Sunday to Sunday. And live streaming is good, isn't it? It's great that we can gather at the same time in our homes or wherever we are to worship, to pray, to reflect with each other. But if we're honest, it's not quite the same as the rich feast of worship and celebration that we have when we gather together. And also on top of that, I think that we are more spiritually hungry than ever too. If one German study is to be believed, then the Google searches of prayer skyrocketed in March as COVID-19 went global. Because in crisis, we pray. And I think that we pray in crisis because we're hungry, often physically hungry, but also emotionally and mentally and spiritually hungry too. And I think we're hungry because there are so many unknowns at the moment, aren't there? And that can cause us to feel afraid or to worry. It can make us really aware of our own needs and the needs of the people around us too. And all of those things can become overwhelming. And so in that crisis, we pray. And God meets us in our needs. So like the disciples, we too can learn to pray. And we don't learn to pray because we want to get better results, as if kind of there's a magic prayer that if we get it right, then the message will get through and God will hear and respond to us. But rather we learn to pray because we want to get to know the one that we speak to better. We're going to follow a pattern of prayer that's from the 24/7 prayer movement, and it uses the acronym PRAY, which is really helpful because it's easy to remember. And we begin by pausing. We stop to remind ourselves that we are speaking to God. And then we reflect. We reflect on who God is and what God does. And as we reflect on that, we rejoice because we remember that God is powerful and loving and faithful. And so then we can ask. We ask with confidence, having remembered who God is, because we know that nothing is too big for his power and nothing is too small for his care. And then finally we yield, or we say yes to God, and we choose to trust him. And so there's going to be times over the coming weeks that we take time to learn and to practice each of those different aspects of this pattern of prayer. But for now, perhaps let's begin by just making time to remind ourselves that when we pray, we come to God, we come to the person of God, and we talk honestly with him. Let's be honest about how we're feeling, about how overwhelmed we are, about perhaps how lonely we are, what we're struggling with, what we're afraid of. Matthew chapter 6, verse 6 says this: "Here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so you won't be tempted to role play before God. Just be there as simply and honestly as you can manage. The focus will shift from you to God, and you will begin to sense his grace." Let's spend some time doing that now.
Thank you.
God, I thank you that I don't have to be a superhero to please you in prayer. Thanks that you take me just as I am, with all my faults and foibles. I yield myself to your acceptance and kindness, and I give myself to you today. Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of blood. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story.
Going to spend a few minutes in prayer now. It might be hard to do this in front of your TV or computer or even on a tiny phone screen. Wherever you are, let's just take a moment to become aware that although we're scattered, we are joining together as God's family, bringing our concerns and our prayers to our loving Heavenly Father, through whom we are united in heart. As we come into God's presence, we are aware that there are things we've done or said that we're not proud of, or things we haven't done or said that we're aware that we should have done. And so first of all, we're going to bring those things to God in the words of a confession. Father eternal, giver of light and grace, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in what we have thought, in what we have said and done. Through ignorance, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We have wounded your love and marred your image in us. We are sorry and ashamed and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and lead us out from darkness to walk as children of light. Amen. And now a prayer for the world. God of love and hope, you made the world and care for all creation. But the world seems strange right now. The news is full of stories about coronavirus. Some people are worried they might get ill. Others are anxious for their family and friends. Be with them and help them to find peace. We pray for the doctors and nurses and scientists and all who are working to discover the right medicines to help those who are ill. Thank you that even in these anxious times, you are with us. Help us to put our trust in you and keep us safe. Amen. And now we pray for our neighbours. Every Thursday evening at the moment, we step outside our door or put our head out of our window and clap for our NHS and for those who are the key workers at this time. We smile or wave to our neighbours as we pass. So right now, just think about your neighbours up and down your street. Think of particular people and bring them to God in your prayer. And now a prayer for those who are feeling ill. And now we pray for people who are alone. Not just the elderly, but others we might know who live alone. That might be you as you are joining in with this service. God of compassion, be close to all those who are in isolation and who live alone. In their loneliness, be their consolation. In their anxiety, be their hope. In their darkness, be their light. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we're going to gather all our prayers together as we finish by saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Thank you so much for joining with us in prayer today. Don't forget you can email us with your prayer requests and things you'd like us to pray for you. And the email address is prayer@st.tees.org.uk.
Who?
For every battle, for every heartbreak, for every circumstance, I believe it's you are my fortress, you are my portion, you are my hiding place. I believe for every battle, for every heartbreak, for every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress. Yes, you are my portion. You are my hiding place. Yeah, I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe for every blessing, for every promise, for every breath I take, I believe that you are provider. Yes, you are protector. Yes, you are the one I love. Yeah, I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, life. I believe you are. I believe you are. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I'm here with you. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life.
Thank you so much for joining us for worship today. We hope that you have been blessed and uplifted by your time with us this morning. We'd love you to join us in the adventure of prayer this week. And a couple of ways in which you can do that would be, if you'd like to join with others, would be to connect in with our daily prayer. We've got morning prayer happening at 8 o'clock Monday to Friday. It's happening using the Lectio 365 app and taking place on Zoom. We've got night prayer happening, which is a simplified form of compline, happening at 9:30 p.m. Monday to Friday. If you want to find out details of how to join in with either of those, they're all on the church website under the section that's marked Live Well in Lockdown, or it's on social media or our regular Connect mailings. So do join us for regular prayer if you'd like to. If you'd like someone to pray with you about anything you're facing, We have a dedicated email address, which is prayer@st.tees.org.uk. If you'd like someone to pray for you about something that's happening in your life, do send us an email at that address. But now let's just pray a prayer blessing as we finish. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. So that brings our service to a close today. In a minute, our post-service chat opportunities are going to get started. The youth will be having their Zoom room in just a few minutes. And of course, the opportunity just to enter some comments on the YouTube stream. Say hello to us while you're online. But before you go, we'd love to show you a couple of videos. There's two short videos from Rob and Susie Shearsby and Ali Bell. They're both involved in a local company in Morecambe, and they're just telling us a bit of the story of how they've sought to live well in lockdown and to live out their faith in practice with regards to their workplace. So we'd love you to watch those two videos from them. And then Sally Wolfcheck is going to be reminding us of ways we can get involved in donations for the Olive Branch Food Bank. So enjoy those.
Hi everyone, my name's Rob Shearsby and I have a window cleaning business. And like many other businesses recently, we have been extremely challenged, confused, uncertain about how to operate and deal with the COVID-19 situation as it unfolds. So I set up my business 10 years ago now. I've been very fortunate. I've got a wonderful staff team and many, many loyal customers that have been with me for a long time. And we sort of work from Preston Way right up into the Lake District through to Penrith. Particularly, we have quite a lot of customers who are vulnerable, many of them quite elderly. And we're one of those fortunate businesses that have started phasing back into work over recent weeks because we work outdoors and we can socially distance from people. So we've been very blessed in that respect, but I took on quite an enormous task to try and speak to everybody either via text message or with quite a lot of people by of a certain generation anyway, by the telephone. And it just made me reflect how vulnerable some of these people are and how isolated they feel, particularly people who live on their own, who are quite elderly, don't have any family nearby. And a lot of these people who have supported me as a business for a lot of years, it just made me sort of reflect on how, although we're a window cleaning business, we're out there working in our community. And if we could be a point of contact and help anybody, I wanted to put a message out there to people. And it made me think from talking to, we probably have 2,500, nearly 3,000 customers now, from talking so far to a fair few of those I've got through, that people are generally quite scared and afraid. And I think in a lot of the services we've been talking about being kind, haven't you? And just being that really kind and loving towards people and listening to them and being able to be there to for just people to talk to.
Being a friendly face as well, yeah. Doing something normal.
But from a distance.
Every day, from a distance.
Yeah, so it is quite alien in a way because you can't have that interaction. But fortunately through the telephone or whatever, you can talk to people without actually having that face-to-face contact. So yeah, I've been overwhelmed really by the support I've had from the lads in the business, the support I've had from the customers and the wider community. It have all been so encouraging to us as a business, and I just wanted to share our little story really of how we're dealing with it. And my heart goes out to every business owner who is trying to make sense of the situation at the moment and act in an ethical and moral way and balance that out with the financial implication and the burden of this virus as it works its way through society and how we adapt and deal with that going forwards. So yeah, that's our story.
Yeah, and I just want to say thank you as well to all our friends that have sent just really lovely encouraging messages and asking after us, and Rob especially, and our amazing team that work for Rob, they've just been so overwhelmingly supportive. And even though they were really worried about whether they were going to get paid and what was going to happen to their jobs and the business, they must have been so worried. They were just, you know, whatever needs to be done, Rob, we're here for you, we'll support you. And so I feel like God's overwhelmingly blessed us through that. And also we had people offer us money if we needed the support, and it's just been amazing. So thank you to everybody. Okay, thank you.
Hi guys, for those of you that don't know me, my name is Ali Bell. I work for Aquabright Window Cleaning, and I just got asked to share a bit after what Rob and Susie have just shared about how the business is functioning with the current situation of COVID-19. And for me, I found it really challenging, actually. So I was put on furlough for 3 weeks. And for me, I live on my own. So actually that meant I was spending a lot of time on my own. And when we lose the liberties of being able to go outside and see friends or go to the pub or even just go out for a drive, I really understood what it meant to be lonely and to spend a lot of time socially isolated on your own, really. And then when we went back into a work environment, I was really challenged by the last sermon series that we'd done as a 7 p.m. service, where we were talking about effectively being good news on your everyday front line. And for me, often in a working day, it's quite easy to become task focused. So, you know, you've got like 25 houses to clean or whatever. So you go through your list of jobs for the day and it's bum, 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 that's it, great, I can go home. But I've tried to remember what I felt like on furlough, of that moment of real loneliness, being on my own. And I've tried to take that into the workplace. So, as Rob was saying, we've got a lot of elderly customers, but I'm aware that actually the loneliness doesn't just affect the elderly, it's for people of all ages. You know, I'm 24 and I was feeling down being stuck in the house all by myself. And Rob said that, you know, we had sort of almost 2,000 customers, and actually I can look at their names on a sheet of paper and know who they are because we've got a relationship. We go around there every month or 2 months. I know how many kids they've got or what they did as a job or what they do. So actually, from a socially distant area, they might be, you know, 10 metres down the garden. I've been trying to take the time to actually just stop and ask how they're actually doing, because I'm aware that not all of them have a significant other or any children nearby or a partner to talk to. That actually, the milkman, the postman and the window cleaner are probably the only people they get to talk to in a month. So that's something that's really challenged me, is actually how am I being effective on the front line and how am I taking my faith into the front line. So that's something I found really effective. And actually, sometimes I think we can overplay what it means to be a Christian. And, you know, we think to be effective on our front lines, we have to physically heal the sick or, you know, let the blind see. But actually sometimes it's just a case of taking the opportunity that's presented in front of us. And that's something I found really challenging. So I just wanted to share that with you guys, and I hope you guys are all staying safe. Thank you.
I wonder how many of these you've seen on your daily walk or exercise. I'd really like to tell you about something else you can look out for in your daily exercise. I've started volunteering with the Olive Branch, which I'm sure most of you know is an incredible service that collects and delivers food to people who, because of health or financial or many other problems, are unable to access food for themselves and their families. At this time, many of their donation points are closed because they were in churches or doctor surgeries or different places that we are now unable to access. So some of us have got a bit creative in how we collect food. I've heard of one neighbourhood local to us that have set up a WhatsApp group because they're all quite friendly with each other. And one night a week, they all leave something like this on their doorstep. One person goes round, collects it all, and then brings it to the food bank the next day, which is wonderful. I've recently set up a donation point outside our house, which isn't for everyone, but I've put a poster outside with a date on saying, please bring food on this date for the local food bank. And that's tomorrow for me, so hopefully it will be well supported. I do understand that not everybody can donate, and it's really important. The most important thing is to stay safe and follow the government guidelines for yourself. But you could pray for us, which would be amazing. Please pray for all the volunteers, the people we serve, the community. They really need our prayers. The staff at the Olive Branch, the managers, the delivery people, that we will have enough people to do all these valuable jobs. And of course, there is a food bank in Morecambe as well, the Morecambe Bay Food Bank. And I know they're being really creative in how they collect food as well. So please support them also. Thank you.
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please, again. I need you. Lord, I need you. Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul. I need you. Yes, God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet. Sound of a symphony to my ears, like holy water on my skin. Yeah. Oh. Dead men walk enslaved to sin. I wanna know about being born again. To the riverside, take me under bad times. I need you, oh God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips.
Oh yes, it is.
It's like the sound of a symphony in my ears. It's like your grace, God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. I don't wanna abuse your grace, God. I